In the early 1920s, one invention would signal the start of the modern era and the dissemination of information around the world. For the first time, the events of history could be reported as they happened to almost anywhere on Earth. While this invention had been around since just past the turn of the century, it was during the Roaring Twenties that it began to change the world. That historic invention was radio. Welcome, fellow YouTubers. The Roaring Twenties Radio channel brings you another video on early radio. To those of you that have already subscribed, you have my thanks. For those of you that haven't, please hit the subscribe button and the like button. And don't forget to tell a friend. I'd appreciate your support. Thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm Dan Dames, your host here on the Roaring Twenties Radio YouTube channel. This video is our second live interview with someone who has a direct connection to early radio, Alfred Henry Grebe's grandson. Alfred Grebe was the founder of A.H. Grebe & Company back in 1914. Alfred Grebe had three children, and one of them was a daughter, Stephanie Margaret Grebe, born on August 12, 1922. In 1945, Stephanie would marry a man named George Davidson Meir. They would have a son named George Davidson Meir, Jr. And now, for the first time, Alfred Grebe's grandson George has agreed to be interviewed and will tell you the story of his grandfather. Now let's go to George Meir, Jr.'s home and meet him. He'll tell you all about his grandfather, Alfred Henry Grebe. Hello, everybody. This is Dan Dames from the Roaring Twenties Radio YouTube channel, and I'm here with George Meir, the grandson of Alfred Grebe. And he's here to tell us all about his grandfather and maybe a lot of things most of you didn't know about Alfred Grebe. So, George, thanks for agreeing to this interview.
Thank you, Dan.
Just go ahead and tell us the story.
Okay. My grandfather was born on April 4th, 1895, in Richmond Hill, Long Island, which is part of Queens. Mm-hmm. His parents were nurserymen, as mm-hmm. were his grandparents, and a lot of his life took place on that property. That's where the factory and everything else was. Mm-hmm. My mother was the firstborn, Stephanie, born in 1922. The factory was completed in 1922. My mother was born in 1922, and their home was completed in 1922, all within 30 days.
Oh, wow.
So he was a very busy man.
And no kidding.
In August. I do have the presentation of all the photographs from May 22 until the factory was born, and it's very interesting to see how they built a modern building with basically hand tools back then.
Wow.
Grandpa got his first interest in radio probably 1904. His father bought him a book about sound, and in there was a reference to hearing things in the air. And that tweaked his interest. His father died in 1905 when he was 10 years old. And he proceeded on in 1909 when he was 14. He utilized the kitchen table in the home, and he and his friends would build crystal sets. From there, he went off to sea and spent a year or two out as a radio man on a ship. There were different various ship and shipping companies that he worked with. One went bankrupt, but anyway, when he returned home, there was still interest in radio, and in 1914, he converted the old shed on the back property into a small radio lab. Interest continued to grow, and he built a somewhat larger factory in 1918 to continue on with the business. From there, the business grew at a huge rate, and the factory that we know was built and completed in 1922. I'm sorry that the factory was added onto in 1925 for excess capacity. Unfortunately, at that point, economic things were changing, and the capacity of the factory, which was about 100,000 units a year, exceeded the demand. His most successful set was the synchrophase. Started in about 1924. They had varying models, and the technology was changing very quickly. So year to year, there were major changes made in it, but it appeared to be the same set. When it started, it took three dials to tune in. And one of the technological advances, which I think is entertaining, is that they eventually tied those wheels together with bead chain. But it was still very, very simple to tune. Now, one of the things that they had was straight line frequency, where they took the dial of the radio, which originally was open at both ends. There were fewer stations at both ends, and everything was jammed into the middle. And through engineering and electronics at the time, they split that up so the dial became even. So it was very, very easy to tune a set. Another thing that they did, eventually they put a light in the middle dial so you could see what you were doing when you were tuning the radio. Mm-hmm. So that went on until 1927, and then they got into a synchrophase 7, which was pretty different. It was a single tuner radio. And then they went into the AC6, which was their first venture into that. I have one upstairs. And one of the big differences in those sets is that instead of using the fabricated metal parts, a lot of the parts were cast white metal. And nearly 100 years later, not too many of them survived. I see now that the hobbyists are rebuilding those parts. It's a very tedious chore, but it's being done. And it makes the radios workable again. Mm-hmm. So that was a glitch, but they didn't know about it at the time.
Right.
From there, they went into the modern AC sets, and I have several of those around too that are strictly AC powered and more sophisticated, more powerful, and more like what we have today. And, you know, we've got to remember that what we have today as far as electronic equipment, as far as for entertainment, this all goes back to the late teens and early 20s as far as the technologies that we have are improvements upon what all of these people did.
Right.
And I'm talking about Sarnoff and Atwater Kent and the rest of them that, you know, they dedicated their lives to what they did. In 1932, business was such that he declared bankruptcy and was in the process of starting out fresh with Grebe Radio and Television. And that was something, those sets were private label through Gayrod. And from what I can tell and from what I'd always heard, that the Gayrod was a very, very high quality product, which he demanded. And right in the middle of this, he was ill. He had an operation and had a pulmonary embolism, and he died in October of 1935.
Wow.
At 40 years old. So,
and he died from ulcers.
Well, he had ulcers.
Yeah, and that's, we cure that today with an antibiotic. And
well, he had ulcers and one burst at home.
Yeah.
And they hauled him off to the hospital, and he was operated on, and there was peritonitis and everything else, you know. Right. And they had no antibiotics, and they had no blood thinners. And he was recovering quite well, and they came in and turned him over on his bed and broke a piece of a large blood clot loose. So a pulmonary embolism, and he was done. They couldn't do anything about it.
What a shame.
So from then on, Grandma kept the relationship with Gayrod open a couple years. But it, for whatever reason, she didn't feel that she wanted to keep going with
There was really nobody to take over for him.
No, Mom was 13, Alfred was 9, yeah. and Camilla was 11. So the kids had nothing. And after the company was bankrupt, most of the people found other employment. You know, his engineers and his ad staff and everybody else. And my mother said the marketing man stuck with him until he passed. And that was it. So, as far as what he did, very dedicated to it. He was very active in the industry. You know, his friends were all of the prominent radio people at the time. He started broadcasting in 1924. And basically, stations were a means to have something for the radios to listen to. And commercial broadcasting, as we know it now, didn't come until 26. My grandfather and several of the other men, and I've got the documentation in my scrapbooks, fought advertising tooth and nail. Keep it in the newspapers was the way they looked at it. They mm-hmm. didn't want to trash up radio with advertising. And they kind of lost on that one.
Right.
So that was interesting. In 1928, well, before then, I mean, it was WAHG and some other satellite stations were in existence. WGMU was mobile in the back of a Lincoln, and they went to the horse races and athletic events and whatever around New York City. WRMU was on Douglas Rigney's boat, and Douglas Rigney was his VP. And I've got pictures of that, very well equipped, and they chased everybody, including rum runners, with that thing. And then in 26, he went to commercial broadcasting, and WABC, the Atlantic Broadcasting Company, was formed. And it was the Atlantic Broadcasting that was sold to William Paley in 1928 to... Paley had a network, but no stations. And my grandfather made Atlanta Broadcasting available. And WOR in New York was also for sale, but he bought Atlantic because it was less money. It was still a lot of money, but it was less money.
Right.
So that was that. And so they operated as WABC for many years. I think WCBS was owned by some little station out in Iowa, and they didn't get their hands on it until, I believe, the 40s. Mm-hmm. So that was the history behind that. So it hasn't always been WCBS.
Right.
And a lot of things have happened there. But it was an exciting time, but it got him back focusing in manufacturing, which he loved. Mm-hmm. A lot of the very interesting things in a radio came out of the Grebe Laboratories. The other thing that he was quite close to President Coolidge. And my grandmother has contended that the first radios in the White House were Grebe's. And that makes some sense because it goes back to 1922 when Coolidge took over as president. I've got a letter in the back from Mrs. Coolidge to my grandfather thanking him for the radios in the White House during their time in the White House. Another friend was Herbert Hoover. And I speculate that one of the reasons he kept going until the bitter end was he was close enough to Hoover that I'm sure Hoover assured him and the rest of the country that things would improve. And they didn't.
Right.
Not in time.
Right.
So that may have been what happened, that he had enough faith in Herbert Hoover to keep moving. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so they had a beach house that they bought in 22 or 23. And it was on Long Island. It was called Oak Beach, and it was an island off of Babylon. And they lived there in the summertime. And Grandpa bought a Wheeler Playmate boat, and he fished. And I've got movies of him fishing on the boat in suit and tie with all of his buddies, and they had a blast just fishing and running in the ocean and living life. He had a very serious business attitude and also a fun-loving attitude. And the family spent summers down there until well after he passed. As far as other parts of his life, my mother would talk about it, and he was very, very good to the kids and to my grandmother, and she always had the very best. They lived well. They did not live in excess, but they lived very well mm-hmm. and very comfortable. And they traveled. I mean, I asked my mom a long time, you know, years and years and years and years ago, because they would go to California quite often. And how did you get there? And I never thought of the train. But, you know, that's what they did. And when the company was being dissolved, Grandpa sent them out there in 1932 to spend the year out there rather than to be home going through this.
Right.
So Mom and Alfred and Camilla and Grandma all went out, spent a year, and then he joined them and came back. So, you know, we've got the filming of the opening of the Olympics. We've got Yosemite. We've got the Grand Canyon. All this stuff on film that they took during these times.
That's great. Because
he wanted to document their life. And we're lucky enough to still have a lot of that. Most of it has been digitized, but some parts that I'd like to see have not. The film is, you know, after 100 years, it's getting a little brittle.
Mm-hmm.
So that was something that was interesting to have. Not a lot of people had a movie camera 100 years ago.
No.
But by golly, he did. And he used it to his great advantage.
That's great, because we'll include that in the video. I'd love to see that, too. We'll have that in the video after.
Well, there's the projector.
Okay.
So, I don't know what else you want to get into. I mean, we're savers. My mother was a saver. I mean, she got a lot of things. When my grandmother remarried in the 40s and broke up the home, a lot of the documentation from the company was given to her, and she didn't let one scrap of it go. So over the years, a lot of collectors and a lot of people have wanted to document what went on, and they've been guests in my parents' home, and I'm real happy to still have it. It's from every aspect. It's from advertising. It's from where the radio signals were picked up all over the country, and I think there's some even in Europe where they picked up WAHG, and there's things about what went on at the station. They had a big thing at Christmas time and Santa Claus and all that stuff. And my question has always been, who funded that? But it was still something that got interest in the station.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a, well, I can't remember who it is, so I won't go into it, but they just, a lot of it was documenting New York and their lives, but the stations, I mean, there was opera, there was political discussion, just about anything, and of course the news is much different than it is now.
I don't think a lot of people know these days that opera was huge in those days. I mean, think of opera nowadays as a few rich people going to some little, you know, place. Not everybody in the country listening to opera like they did
back
in the 20s.
Well, they did back then.
Yep.
And, you know, I don't, you know, obviously I'm quite a bit younger than the 20s. But, I mean, there are names in here that I've heard that, you know, I'm not familiar with their work, but you look in here and there are opera stars.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was, you know, just good music. And Grandpa loved good music, and specifically organ music. So when he died, they closed down Standard Broadcasting on CBS and did a tribute to him and an hour of organ music. So it was a big deal. I mean, he was very well thought of. As I say, it was a tragedy that he died that young, but the respect that he had has stayed with him. I mean, the sets are still looked at as being among the best that were built in the 20s.
So after he passed, what did his kids go into? Alfred Jr. and
Alfred went into electronics. He went to Rensselaer. And I'm not sure what he did towards the end, but he had a repair shop for radios and televisions, I believe, at one point. That was natural. Camilla became a teacher. And my mother went, she was a physics major, and then she met my dad, and that was over. So dad was in the Navy, and mom's roommate at Goucher in Baltimore.
Your dad was?
My dad was George Meir, Sr.
Okay.
But yeah, he was a naval officer during the Second World War.
Okay.
And mom's roommate at Goucher in Baltimore was, her husband was in the Navy, so he happened to be one of Dad's shipmates. So that's how they got together in 43. And they married just before the end of the war.
Mm-hmm.
And then came back. Grandma remarried in 46 to a GM executive. Bill Harvey was the personnel director for the overseas division at GM. So they split their time between their apartment in Manhattan, and that overlooked the George Washington Bridge. So I spent a lot of time looking up and down the river when I was a kid. And then they had a farm in Bucks County, Pennsylvania. It was a turkey farm, and Grandpa was a gentleman farmer, and that was fun to go to too. So you know, we had a good life. I mean, you look at the life my mother and my father, but my mother, and they just were very interesting, very interested people. And we had a lot of experiences through that we probably wouldn't have otherwise had.
Right.
I mean, my brother went to New York he flew to New York at eight years old.
Wow.
In the early 50s. And nobody flew back then, but he did. One of the things that really was a fascinating thing for me was back in 2001, right after the 9/11 attack, Alfred, my uncle, who was a member of the Radio Club of America, arranged for Dr. Bose to come down and accept the Grebe Award for Excellence. So I went up to that, and we sat and had dinner with Dr. Bose.
Wow.
Which was utterly fascinating. Just
a
very interesting, very humble man that did something that, you know, back in the golden age of radio, the speakers got bigger and bigger and bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And then Bose does this, and the sound is superior.
Right. Amazing.
So that was a very interesting experience for me. And I've been to Richmond Hill, where the factory was, several times, and I've been in the factory two or three times. That is now part of the Jamaica Hospital. And the Jamaica Hospital is situated on the old Grebe property, and it's adjacent to the factory itself. Right.
The original factory is still standing.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
When I was a kid, we went out, and the lawn and the parking lot and everything else was still there. You could see it from Van Wyck Boulevard. Well, now there's a parking garage in front of you. You can't really see. You can see the sides of the building. And you can look up between the buildings and see where the marquee was on the front.
Right.
And the original lamps are out there. And you can get to the upper floor, I mean, with permission.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see that the shape of the pillars that hold the building up. I mean, it's amazing that after 100 years, it's just as sturdy as it was when it was built.
Wow.
And at that point, I mean, I don't know how much poured concrete and steel was being done for, you know, what we would consider now a small commercial building, but it was done right.
Hmm. Wow. Now, it's on Jamaica Hospital property. What's in the building now?
Part of the hospital.
If the hospital is using it.
The medical center.
They are using it.
Yeah.
Good. Good.
Yeah, they bought it for that. Otherwise, I'm sure it would have been torn down.
Okay.
And in 04, shortly before Grandma died, Alfred and I went out and worked with the Historical Society, and they put a plaque on the side of the hospital explaining what it was and why it's historically significant. And also at the Maple Grove Cemetery, naming him as one of the notables buried in that facility.
Wow.
So.
Heck of a life.
It was. It was too short. And.
But he lived more in a short time than a lot of people do who lived to be 80.
Yeah, he accomplished a lot. But you got to remember, he started when he was 14 years old, too. Which not everybody did.
Right, right.
And, you know, it was. One of the family members, because he wrote that his mother had unbelievable patience, and there was a beautiful walnut table in the dining room that's all gouged and busted up, and that's where he built his first radios. So, and, you know, the rest of the house, he's had his equipment and his material. And during the time when he was on the ships, he would tell my great-grandmother what to order so that the guys could keep busy during building these crystal sets.
Mm. So they would build them and sell them?
Build them and sell them.
Did they sell a lot of them? Were they cranking them out, or was it more hand-holding?
I think it was more word of mouth, but it was enough to keep them busy. Mm-hmm. And it was enough to show him that there was a future in this industry.
Mm-hmm.
And I think from what he did, and from the number of sets and the quality and the notoriety that he still enjoys today, the decision that he took was correct. You can argue with whether getting out of broadcasting was a mistake or not, but he didn't like it. He liked manufacturing.
Mm-hmm.
He loved his company. And he wanted to leave that for others to take care of.
Mm. Amazing life. Anything else you care to tell us about him?
No, and I'm at a disadvantage because, as I say, my mother was 13 when he passed. So anything we got was from her, and that's a short lifespan in a child's life.
Right, right.
And a lot from my grandmother, but there again, you know, she pretty much had another life.
Sure.
Afterwards.
Sure.
And went on for another 70 years.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, George, thank you for sitting and for this interview with me. And I greatly appreciate and all the knowledge you've added about Alfred Grebe and his life.
Well, I wish I could think of more that's really fascinating, but.
And I'm glad it seems to have led to a good life for you, too.
It did.
The things you got to do that wouldn't have got.
Really, I look at that, you know, and my cousin said one time, because why don't we go up to Shelter Island off of Long Island. You know, the things that you see, the Hamptons and all of that stuff, that, you know, we just kind of took it as this is the way it was.
That's where everybody lived in the
end. Yeah, I mean, it's the way everything was. And we never thought of a thing of it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's about it for what this is. And if you want to do this again sometime, I'll keep reading.
All right, I will. I will. Thank you, George.
Thank you, Dan. I appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Well, I hope you enjoyed my interview with George Meir, Alfred Grebe's grandson. I want to thank George for letting me into his lovely home that day and spending a lot of time with me working on this video. He provided a lot of new documents, photographs, and home movies never before seen, and I greatly appreciate that. There'll be more videos upcoming here on the Roaring Twenties Radio YouTube channel, so keep an eye out for those. And of course, we'll have our regular documentaries on the men and the radio companies that launched the radio revolution in the 1920s. So until I see you again, take care of yourself. Goodbye.
Well, that's it for this video. There'll be more to come as we continue to investigate the early history of the world's first true mass medium, radio. Thanks for watching.